Okay, welcome guys to Cranial Nerve and their disorders. So we are going to summarize just quickly in a couple of sessions how to approach cranial nerve abnormality. This is a clinical part of it, so we'll cover a little bit of neuroanatomy, although the full neuroanatomy is under the neuroanatomy course, okay? Otherwise, let's start it off, okay? What you need to remember is that cranial nerves, it's usually important to know where they originate, okay? So what you need to know is that the first two cranial nerves actually are not really cranial nerves. They are not true cranial nerves. They don't originate from the brainstem. They are actually just simply an extension of the cortex. Okay, so your cranial nerve 1, which you used to smell with, and your cranial nerve 2, which is your optic nerve, it's simply an extension of the cortex. So that's useful to know for localization. Okay, then you have your next two. Okay, your next two cranial nerves, which is your 3 and 4, which is your trochlea being your 4 and your 3rd being your oculomotor, actually originate in the midbrain. Okay, so if you do remember your neuroanatomy, you can see it here. Your brain stem is composed of 3 sections: your midbrain, which is your highest part. Then the middle is your pons, then the medulla is your the lowest aspect of the brainstem. Okay, so your 4 and 3 originates from here. Then the next 4 cranial nerves actually originate in the pons. Okay, so your 5, 6, 7, and 8. So if you have a patient coming in with a lesion in the pons, she will most likely have 5, 6, 7, and 8 fallout. Okay, so that's useful to know for localization. And then finally, the next 4 cranial nerves, or the last cranial nerves, they are also called, sometimes in our setting you hear them being called as your lower cranial nerves, and simply because they are from the lower aspect of the brainstem, which is your medulla. Okay, so the cranial nerves that originate here is your 9, your 10, your 11, and your 12. Okay, so that's really useful for localization. It's very, very important that you take note of this as we cover more of these pathologies. Okay, moving on to this picture here. So we have touched a bit on it. I just want to highlight something. Okay, whenever you're having a cranial nerve abnormality, it can typically be at 4 main areas, okay, to localize. Okay, so we are assuming this is the cranial nerve here running, then this and nucleus. And nucleus, you see, is in the pons. So we're assuming, let's say, this cranial nerve 7, because cranial nerve 7 originates from the pons. Okay, so remember, cranial nerve 7 supplies all the muscles of facial expression, which we are assuming as this. Okay, muscles of facial expression. Okay, then it runs. So you can have a lesion at number 1. So that means it's the nerve itself as it's running. There's a lesion at the nerve. That's 1. That's where a lesion can be. Number 2, the lesion can be in the pons, right? Because that's where the nucleus is. The nucleus simply means where it originates. Okay, that's where it's supplied. That's its origin in the brainstem. It's called the nucleus. Okay, a lesion can be in this fiber. Remember, the cortex, which is your brain essentially, when we think about brain, this is your brain, has to communicate somehow with your brainstem. These things are not just isolated. So they are typically connected by what we call corticobulbar fibers. Corticobulbar fibers. So they typically connect your nucleus of a cranial nerve to the cortex. And every cranial nerve typically has a corticobulbar fiber connecting it to the cortex. And so you can have a lesion at the corticobulbar fibers. Okay, remember, they come all the way to the cortex. So that's why if you have patients with stroke, it's not really the nerve that is affected, but it's these fibers that connect it. And that's why you do present with a fascial weakness. Yet it's not the cranial nerve that is involved, but the fibers that transmitted to the cortex that are typically affected. And finally, the fourth area where you can have a cranial nerve abnormality is a generalized disease. Okay, if you have something like myasthenia gravis, you have a generalized picture. So that's really typically useful to know. Okay, then the next thing we are going to talk about is what happens when you have multiple cranial nerves. Very common in our setting, you see in neurology, you want to pick up the pattern. Okay, so to pick up the pattern, you need to know where things run, and that's the neuroanatomy. Okay, so for example, perhaps the most common important thing is what you call the cavernous sinus. Okay, the cavernous sinus. Okay, so if you have, what I'm trying to highlight here is that if you have multiple cranial nerve abnormalities, okay, that means you don't just have seven, you have seven, five, four, you're wondering what is going on. Okay, typically you can have three things that can explain a multiple cranial nerve abnormality. It's either you are where the cranial nerves run together. Okay, for example, I will show you now at the cavernous sinus, there are multiple cranial nerves that run there. So if you have a pathology there, it will affect those cranial nerves that run there. Okay, or where they originate, and where do most of the cranial nerves originate? The brainstem. Okay, so if you have a brainstem lesion, okay, then you obviously have multiple cranial nerves abnormal. For example, if you have a lesion in the pons, you have your 5, you have your 6, you have your 7, and your 8 affected. Okay, and finally, you can have multiple lesions. Okay, for example, a common culprit is stroke, for example, or you have basal meningitis or multiple sclerosis. They tend to have patchy lesions all over. So then you have lesions, one lesion here, one lesion here, one lesion here, affecting certain cranial nerves that run wherever they are affecting. And so that's how you approach. So if you find someone who's having cranial nerve abnormality and there are multiple, if you don't want to get lost, just say, doctor, I know it's either where they run together, for example, the cavernous sinus and the what, or where they originate, the brainstem, or we are dealing with a disease that have multiple lesions. And that's very useful to know. Now, the one that we're going to discuss today is your cavernous sinus, okay? Your cavernous sinus is one of your venous dural sinuses, okay? It's typically right in the middle, okay? Right in the middle, just on either side. It's paired. It has your right and your left, okay? It's a paired venous dural sinus, just on either side of the pituitary gland. Okay, now what runs at the cavernous sinus, except for the internal carotid that we're seeing there, or just your sphenoid sinuses that just under, just below the cavernous sinus, is your cranial nerves. And always remember that 3, which is your oculomotor, 4, which is your trochlea, and there's a small one here, 6, which is your abducens, and then V1 distribution, your ophthalmic branch of your trigeminal, and V2, which is your maxillary branch of your trigeminal, they run here. And that's why if you have a patient with what we call cavernous sinus thrombosis, fairly common, you see it here and there in Namibia. It's not so common, but you do see it here and there. They typically have marked ophthalmoplegia. They can't move their eyes because of your 3, 4, 6. Those are responsible for your extraocular muscles, and they can't also feel in the V1 and V2 distribution. They might even have muscle atrophy there, or decreased bulk of the masseter or your temporalis. So that's really, really useful to know. Okay, so at least if you are to know where areas where they run together, this is one of the areas. Okay, if you want to add more, you can. There is something called the cerebellopontine angle. Okay, this is useful because typically you have your 5, your 7, and your 8. Okay, if these are affected, then you have an angle here, but this is beyond the scope of this. You can have what's called jugular foraminal syndrome, where you typically have your 9, 10, and 12. But perhaps the one that is useful to talk about is If you have your lower cranial nerve, lower cranial nerves affected, remember your lower cranial nerve is your 9, 10, okay, 11 and 12, okay? Especially if you have a combined of 10, 11 and 12. Always, always remember that is either you're dealing with an upper motor neuron lesion or lower motor neuron lesion. Now, this is a bit confusing in neurology because, yes, we know that brainstem pathologies are technically upper motor, but they divide it again in upper motor and lower motor. And I'll take you back here quickly. If you look at this, if you come from the nucleus of where the cranial nerve originates and how it runs all the way to whatever muscle it innervates, any lesion in the nucleus or where it runs all the way to the muscle that it innervates is considered lower motor, okay? And then any lesion affecting these cortical bulbar fibers just above the level of the nucleus, okay, it's considered upper motor neuron. That's why, for example, upper motor neuron would be, for example, if we are talking about third or seventh nerve, it would be a stroke. Okay, so it's not really a palsy of the nerve, but it's affecting it. That's why we call it fascial weakness. And then your lower motor, for example, cases like Bell's palsy, they literally affect the nerve itself. Okay, so that's a real palsy. Okay, so that's really, really useful to know. So when you come back, if you have a patient with a 10, 11, and 12, if you have upper motor neuron sign, you have your gag reflex is exaggerated, you typically have what we call a pseudobulbar. Okay. And then if it's lower motor, you are thinking of your bulbar palsy. Okay. I hope that helps a lot. Okay. Then, otherwise, I'll just quickly run through cranial nerve 1. Okay. Cranial nerve 1, very rarely tested. We have highlighted it well in the examination video. However, I just wanted to run through key differentials of anosmia, and that will be it that we'll discuss there. Examination is in the examination video. Okay, always, always remember that some of the most common causes of anosmia is your upper respiratory tract infection. I'm sure all of us at some point in your life, if you had an upper respiratory tract infection, you should have lost some level of smell capability. However, never, never forget conditions like Parkinson's. Okay, Parkinson's is known to cause 10, 15 years before the classic symptoms of Parkinson's, patients will present with anosmia. Then 15 years later, they present with your classic signs of Parkinson's. So that's useful to know. Of course, trauma is a common cause. Again, if you have any trauma, especially to your cribriform plate, especially if it fractures, you will have a problem like that. Okay. Among Parkinson's, there's also things like Alzheimer's. All those neurodegenerative conditions can typically give you that, okay? Please, please never forget your drugs, okay? Especially penicillamine, okay? Can cause a level of that, okay? Other things you can think of is, especially if you have aneurysms of your circle of Willis, okay? Aneurysms at your circle of Willis.